So I've been wanting to do an interview with Mr. NorCal. He's just very like-minded like me. I started watching his videos probably halfway into me researching this whole Flat Earth gig, and I just related to him really well. I think that his channel provides the common man's journey. We're not going to be sitting here trying to break down every single detail on how this model works. We're just going to get to know Mr. Caleb himself. So I'm going to introduce to you guys Mr. Caleb from NorCal Waters. All the links to his like channel, Facebook, all that is in the description down below. So hopefully you guys check that out. And we'll go from there, man. What's going on?
Cool. Thank you so much. I'm here spending time with you, finally. Really glad that you reached out to me, too, and saw me for what I was, just a man on a journey, content, you know. And so, I mean, where should we go from here? Because I could go in any direction, truly.
I want to know how you got into Flat Earth.
Oh, yeah, absolutely. So let's get right into that. I mean, it depends on... where I really want to begin. I was told about the Flat Earth in 2012, but I was part of some secret groups, and we were dealing with what we thought to be our own truth sector of things, and I rushed it off. But then fast forward to 2015, April 22nd, 2015 is Earth Day, and there was some spherical Earth posts all over social network. I was on Facebook at the time. And, you know, there's people in the comments doing just like they would today on any kind of, like, NASA thread or anything. Flat Earth is the truth. But at the time, I saw FE is the truth. And I'm like, what is this FE thing, you know? And I click on the profile. I look at the cover page to try to get more information on what this person's about. And next thing I know, I see a link for a Flat Earth talk. It was the it was a talk on the Higher Side Chats. So there it goes. It was like 9 o'clock at night. I ran into Flat Earth from someone's comment, and I stayed up till probably 3 or 4 in the morning researching Flat Earth that night. So that's how I got into and submerged into Flat Earth. It was Eric Dubé's info right out of the gate, followed by like 6 hours of Matt Powerland trying to jar my mind. As you know, I'm an artist, I'm a muralist, so I really gravitated towards Powerland because he has that kind of perception cracking ability to make me put aside the logic and get involved with like how I feel about this, you know, that kind of approach. So that was the intro for me, and at that point, I mean, I had nowhere else to go but to continue to try to bash this Flat Earth topic into the ground. I was coming from a ancient alien heliocentric guru, you know, panspermia, whatever the case may be, type of thing, you know, complete misdirection in my truth path now that I think about it. And so here I am with hubris thinking I'm gonna like show these Flat Earthers what's up. And for those who have remembered me from those months, I mean, I was a little rude to some of the Flat Earthers who I've befriended now. I don't really communicate too heavily with all of them, but I had to come back on and I'm sorry about, hey, sorry I said all this, that, the other. You got to understand, I was, you know, the psychological impact of going through the material will make you, you know, it'll make you feel a little edgy, you know. So, to some, but yeah.
Well, I mean, I definitely relate to that. For those who might just watch this later on and are just getting into it, the majority of us do not think this is the greatest thing. We definitely make fun of it just like everybody else. The difference between us and someone who refuses is that we challenge ourselves to actually look into the information that's provided. Even if it sounds dumb, it's a challenge to ourselves to prove it to ourselves that what we've been taught is actually accurate. And that's how we got into this whole mess in the first place, because we've just accepted what man has told us as fact. and you don't understand how much evidence there is for this thing. So it's one thing. I encourage anyone, if you're listening to us tonight, to anyone who you hear talk, do not take our word for it. Research it for yourself. And with that, I want to move on and just what are maybe one or two evidence that really like locked it in for you? Like, yeah, I could see why people think this, and this is definitely making me feel like this could be true.
Yeah, the main thing is kind of what it always comes back to, what we say, even in today's age, it's like, there's no curvature. So I realized that this topic had actual little mini academia attached to it. It's not like other subject matters where it's just speculation from start to finish. There is an actual academia that goes along with this, and it reintroduces your senses to yourself and tries to re-empower you with the scientific methodology and how to approach it astutely. And when I kind of started catching wind of this being repeated, and I was like, well, this, I need to adhere to this type of methodology into science and start observing for myself. And aside from the material that you can find, I mean, you have to go out there and you do your own type of thing. So I've made some observations with Sacramento and Lake Tahoe. Sierra Nevada is behind me, 109 miles away. I started running calculations on why I can see certain levels of the El Dorado Hills, the basin, and things like that. And so there's that. And then it was June of 2015. I went to Bodega Bay, and I'm at the bay, and I'm looking over at the ocean, and I'm seeing, of course, flat horizon. I'm seeing it with new eyes. You know, you always assume that you're on a ball, but even when you see your flat horizon, and there it goes, I'm thinking, wow, I see the sunlight vectoring up right there to the sun in the clouds. And I'm like, you know, because I've been constantly pondering this before I got out there. And when you go see it for yourself, you feel it. You see it, you feel it. And that was it for me. Water always being flat is a big deal for me, too. Right here, I'm in California. I've always gone to Santa Cruz. I've been to the beach. I mean, plenty of people go to the water side and see that kind of thing. You know, you can always extrapolate from there. But, yeah, that was it. Water's flat. From a perspective that I couldn't actually gain myself, studying Polaris and studying Polaris and seeing the motion of the stars, you know, how that kind of pretty much can prove the geocentricity just from an academia side where you're just looking at the paper, because both models do work on paper. That was one of the paper sides of it, and aspects of it that I was like, okay, I like that. You know, if you think about it, you're pondering, okay, well, spinning 1,000 miles an hour, shooting 67,000 miles an hour, going 500,000 or whatever, 500 million, whatever the case, 500,000, then yeah, this Polaris should not be there, you know.
Exactly. Awesome. Well, those are, for most of us, those are pretty much key points that we hit on, because you can't, that's evidence that you just cannot refute. I mean, curvature, right. The lack of curvature, water being mm-hmm. level, I mean, those are real things. Those are something that everyone can go out and measure and test for themselves and prove it to themselves that there is no curvature. One of the things I also want to say is that for anyone who is coming into this, understand that we're not dumb. We realize that the pictures that most people consider as evidence, we have looked into and realized that they are all fake, all CGI. There's always something that is 100% wrong with them. So the evidence of you saying, well, look at the pictures. We've studied them. We understand that those pictures are all doctored. They're not real. We have 2017 and we have no pictures of Earth. And that should be right. A really big red flag to most people. I know that was one of the first things that came to my head when I was thinking about this whole flat Earth. It was like, but we have pictures, right? Well, guys, we don't. That's what they think. They make us believe we have pictures, but you really have to do some research. I mean, there's great channels out there. And that leads me to another question is, who are some of your, and I already heard you say it, but dig in a little bit more, like who are some of your favorite flat earth researchers, just in case anyone hasn't came across them, most likely they have, but if they haven't, you know, go into who and maybe why for some of them, because they're very different, you know.
Yeah, and I'm going to kind of do it in just chronological order to kind of keep my thoughts in perspective. You know, aside from, and I'm mentioning all this, aside from whatever controversy is behind any of the individuals mentioned as well, pretty much everyone has some kind of saying, you know, no one's perfect in this. So starting off, Eric Dubé came in with some great information. I attached to that. That was my my unveiling of Flat Earth information. So of course, there's Eric Dubé. I like Math Powerland for setting a passion or a lighting a fire. His arguments as far as embodying somebody who is a flat earther, I like that. He has like a nice bioenergetic feel as far as living confidently as a flat earther. So I really admire him for that. Even though there's, you know, like I said, there's somebody you could target anyone in this or whatever. I really appreciate the information from what I like to call the OGs. This isn't a content provider as far as YouTube's concerned, but these are people that I had sought out and familiarized myself with in some of the groups. And there's Jason Dang, there's Michael Conkey and Antonio Diaz and Simon. I forget his last name, forgive me for that. But so there's other commenters who are really into the science behind this, the electromagnetism, and there's that. As far as going back to YouTube channels, I really respect Carly Sunshine Madrono's information. He changed his life from Curious Life of a Flat Earther to Curious Life. He has a really good gyroscope movie or clip that I like. And the Morg Isle, his long drawn out, long discussions and analytics on certain things. That was perfect for me at a time where all I wanted to do was research for 4 hours. You know, kids go down, boom, I'll start, and I'll just go until my brain literally won't go anymore. Morgan was great for that. He's got like 2 hour segments, 4 hour segments on things. So I got a ton of him in. Then it kind of grew into other people who were kind of coming into making channels that were more blog like, and that was where I wanted to connect with the personability, personable aspect of some of the other flat earthers. I like people who operate from a candid nature or a hard nature, so there's Flat Earth FEA and Tom Scott News. That's my guy. You know, I love the way he's local too. He's Sacramento, and he's funny. You know, there's that. And for anyone else who's curious about who I've been watching, I have a list in my a YouTube channel called Flat Earth Teach the Controversy. It's a playlist, and I've been trying to leave breadcrumb trails of all the information and the science and academia behind this as I've been going. So there should be some links there. So everything I've mentioned is literally, it's in there. Yeah.
Yeah. I agree. There's so much variety when it comes to content in this community. Yeah, we have a lot of people complaining about who's a shill, who's not. You know, you
can't forget ODD. You
know that. Yeah, that's the man right there. That's the man. That's the man who helped me get a lot of my understanding of this, because he definitely broke it down in a way that most people have. I look up to the dude because he definitely elevated the quality of the videos the way they should be made, as far as researching and just production value. The guy knows his stuff. He's definitely.
There's a saying that goes, if you can kick it with kings but have the common touch, his product, his quality, his delivery is like king status to me, but yet he can relate to the common man, you know? He can kick it with kings, but got the common touch, so
that's awesome. Definitely for that man, because he does big things. I enjoy a lot of that stuff. I could sit there and listen to 2-3 hours, and usually that's how I get by my day. I find some videos. I'm always looking for learning more about this. Doing research that, I mean, it's getting to a point where we haven't got new research coming in, but just right. learning it and learning how to defend our beliefs in this environment is really important. Especially like when I make videos, I do a lot of research just so I make sure that I do my best to try to present the most accurate information as possible. I might hold a slight bias towards what the scriptures say, what the Bible says. But again, that's kind of where my channel comes in. You know what I mean? Like, I know everybody's not going to dig that. There's a weird stigma in the Flat Earth community that if you're a Christian, it's like there's like this negativity that hovers around you. And I want to say that shouldn't be the case. I think we all should just all right. unite and definitely understand that not all of us are definitely made equal. We are trying to do our best with the understanding research. I mean, just think about where we're coming from 2 years ago to today. It's a lot of us think completely different. This has definitely changed us for the best for most. But and that leads me to another question is, how has Flat Earth changed you as a person?
Man, that's deep. It has changed me from top to bottom. You know, this happened today. I found myself listening to an older song before I went flat. And, you know, songs can kickstart just the feeling you had from back then or whatever, even if it's high school, if you're going back that far. And I had this song go by, and I thought to myself, man, so much has changed within me. The way it matured me, Flat Earth matured me. I have become a little bit more accepting of everybody around me, both fortunate and unfortunate, because it levels the playing field. And of course, we all call each other equals. And I'm not trying to make myself look like a saint over every kind of ball or anything like that. But the fact is that I feel more intimate. I feel like we're definitely here together. There's nowhere we can go but to acknowledge each other now. And so that has been really powerful to me. And I imagine more things are going to come from this development and of knowing of the flat motion of this plane. Of course, we're talking about this. Once you finally accept the fact that there's no curb, there's no wall, there's no big bang, what are you going to say? Now, I understand that there's other atheist flat earthers, or there's satanic flat earthers, Christian flat earthers, Gnostic flat earthers. So I can't speak for any other styles, whatever preference I'm going to call that. But for me personally, it has allowed me a more valid talking point to create the change that I would want to really see in the world. Anyone can tease me for wanting to say this or call me some kind of somebody who wants something on a silver platter, but I would like to see some free energy happen because of this exposure. I would like to see a case versus like NASA so we can get a universal stipend so that we can see the quality of life get better for our friends and our family. That's why I care about this subject matter so much. So it's elated me to want to do more art, talk to people, meet people that I have never met before. I'm an introverted personality type, and of the introverts, I'm more of the extroverted ones. I'm one of the most extroverted introverted types, and this really just clicked something for me and made me want to just get to people and see in their eyes that they are geocentric. And that's what all of 2016 really was about, meeting flat earthers. So I'm close to 30 now.
Man.
So it's been a good impact on my life.
How many people you think you might have personally been able to I hate to say convert, but make realize
or awaken something. I can't. They don't actually tell me, but it's been maybe around 7 or 8, something like that. first of all, the only one that really matters is yourself. Of course, we talked about this, but flattening yourself is the only, that's you're the only person you'll ever flatten truly.
Oh, I think we lost them real quick.
We lost.
Oh, no, we're back. Okay. That was weird. It just kind of froze.
Gotcha.
But no, keep going. Last thing I heard was flattening yourself, and I love that saying.
I know. Anyway, I just was going to say that the only person you'll ever really get to flatten is yourself, as opposed to, you know, I can't claim to have flattened anybody. It's just one of those things where the dialogue's open. It's between this me and this other person, and it's on themselves to get to that point, you know? And so... Yeah, but I'd say the number is close to like 8 or 9, something like that. 7, 8, 9, something like that. That's and more, I've got family right now who are researching. So,
have you lost any relationships due to this?
No.
No?
Because the thing about me is that prior to even discovering Flat Earth, I was very open about my fringe topics that I was interested in. And I remind you, I was a heliocentric ancient aliens type of guru, type of dude. And so everybody expected something strange and abnormal to come out of my mouth anyway. And so my parents are fine, you know, with it on both sides. And my mother-in-law is interested in it, you know, and my sister, it's no big deal. Like there's certain things I know it's okay to go into, and other things we're not. Because my sister and I were kind of more talking about things like death and certain family, because we had some family death in 2016. So the topic doesn't need to be about Flat Earth right now. I'm a little patient. Like I said, people are investments in time. If it's family, I mean, think about it. I got so many years left with them. There's no fire. So they know my example. They're seeing how I'm living. And I think in time, when they're ready to open the dialogue with me, we'll go there. But I'm a pretty patient. Like I said, I'm pretty patient, and I'm methodical too. So I've been good.
Yeah, I mean, just look, guys, I spoke to him what might have seemed like an hour and a half, 2 hours, which went by super fast. First time even really having conversation. And I learned a lot from the patience thing. You could definitely see it. Like, you're very calm. You have a very calm like aura about you that even you listen, you know what I mean? I remember I started talking, I was like, wait a second, this dude like listening to me. Like you care what other people have to say, rather than have somebody just talk over you, you know. That's important, especially in this community where it seems like people just want to be heard and they don't care what the other person has to say.
Sure.
And that's important. I think that's really important.
Yeah.
So I'm happy. I'm happy that I came across your channel. I'm happy that I got to interview you and talk to you guys. This is the kind of stuff that I want to do more on my channel. It's just like finding the time. That's really the hard part. Like NorCal, he's a father. I'm a father. I'm doing a stream at 12:41 my time, which I'm in the East Coast. Because of him, because I understand the same thing. You know, it's hard to find time to do these things sometimes. So, no, this is great. I had an opportunity. My wife is out of town with the kids. I say, I don't care what time we have to do it. Let's just get it done, because I just like talking. I like to get to know how others think in this community. I just want to fellowship and just be around like-minded people.
Thank you, man. Thank you. Because it's been, well, I take pride in the fact that I am a small channel. It's kind of quite the opposite, but I love the grassroots of the small channels who befriend the small channels and support each other. Because that's where this has really felt alive for me. You know, if I were in it for other reasons, like likes, subs, and to avoid my commenters, this wouldn't be real for me. So I'm doing it as an exposed thing. I'm kind of like, I mean, really, I'm just kind of putting my heart out there. And I felt from your intention, this is a good guy. I mean, we both got it going on. We kind of got the Vin Diesel thing going on, living our lives a quarter mile at a time.
Right.
No, I'm playing. But yeah, I am willing and open to commit to doing this with you for however long it goes, bro. I mean, truly.
Yeah, I appreciate that. Most people don't realize.
Can I say something?
Yeah, go ahead.
Before we go there, but, and I mean this, the reason I mean the sincerity behind the connection, this is between you and I, is because you do take the scripture literal, and I respect that. I take the open-minded free association literal or important. It's very important to me as well. So let's just convert that to dominant infinite plane, just to be basic for a second. I would really hope and appreciate that as a domer, that your firmament type, you would support me and wish me well. And maybe be like, you know, give me the bro hug or the bear hug before I venture off to go across the plane, if that's my destiny. If I find out that if I hit my head on something and I got to come back, I hope that you will be there with open arms to receive me, because this will be my home. And it'll, you know what I mean by that?
Oh, yeah. No.
I'm just saying, either I'm just putting it out there as I'm willing to live this with other flat earthers in the hopes that it doesn't matter who's right. I just hope that we can each get each other's blessing on whatever journey we're going to be going on. You know, kind of thing.
Yeah. And that's anyway. Very important. I'm glad you said that because I don't hold a grudge. I don't care what you're like, what someone's view of the shape of the earth is, as far as, is it dome? Is it planar? Is it both? Is it concave? I do not care. We have to understand that we're in it together, and no matter what happens, we understand that we have been lied to in the greatest scale. I mean, this is like, literally, it is life-changing. It changed my life because the simplest thing is where we live. And I know there's people who say, but what does that matter? It matters so much, because if they can make you think that you're on this endless roller coaster ride on this nonsense of a ball, then they can tell you anything, and they have taken that away from you. I mean, it's that important. And when you're like really 100% realize that we are stationary, Earth is flat, either we're covered by a dome or we're not, whatever it is, that is huge. It literally changes. Like, I can't go to see a movie. I can't watch TV. I can't go to a Disney park. I can't do anything without seeing symbolism or truth in plain sight. And it's huge. It literally it affects relationships with me, because I'm constantly talking about it. I can't do nothing about it. I mean, people have told me, like, you used to be cool, man. Like, well, what would you think would make someone change that much? It has to be something quite important.
Thank you.
In order for that to take place, it's a decision.
That's the one thing that grinds my gears. So you're telling me that you've been alive for 34 years. I've been alive for 34 years, but all of a sudden, I have the psychological slip that makes me invalid, because I've now researched a topic that we've never been privy to. I mean, this is the thing that stuns me sometimes, and why there's days I won't engage anyone, because I feel the psychological distance between what has really taken place here. This deception and this lie is like reaching across thousands of miles to grab someone's attention. It's a hard thing to do.
Yep, it really is. It's
where the art comes in.
It really is life-changing. I mean, when you hear some of the flat earthers and the passion that comes, we might not get everything correct. I mean, we're all trying to learn, but when you see the passion behind someone's research or just journey, it should make people wake up, just that alone. And that's why I gravitated to your channel. I'm a small channel, right? But ODD gave me an opportunity to just talk with him. I am not as that outgoing. I still told him, like, dude, what even made you come in and accept my invitation for an interview? Like, I had like probably like 4 videos made. You know what I mean? It was things like that that I realized this community is not the same as most communities. Like, yeah, we have inner battles, but for the most part, most of us are out to help each other out, help get to know one another, because it can be lonely at times. It doesn't have to be, but it can be.
And that's why I reacted the way I did. First of all, I'm real impressed with ODD's candor and the way he kind of assists in things that no one will ever know or see. He's a workhorse for building the network. And quite honestly, this could be the result of his intervention, his sprinkling some assistance on me, helping out with you over there. And this could really be hindsight, something that ODD might have had going. You know what I mean? Not to say that, you know, I'm just saying in a weird loopy way. But anyway, I think it's great that our channels are coming together and talking about this, because this is exactly what happened to me. As I thought to myself, I just got done saying this. We have got to put ourselves in a position to let people know that there's a friendship and network that's here. Like, that was my role. That's what I thought to myself. Well, how is this going to really take off in real life if people aren't getting together in some way, shape, or form? And so I kind of did that. I wanted to manifest that so that people can see that it's possible, my family included. It doesn't matter who. And I brought people together who thought they were never going to meet another flat earther in person. So that, I mean, the people that I met at some of these things, it's been super emotionally charged. And some people have been very thankful for the things that we've got going on now. I mean, if I could tell you about all the meetups we've done in Sacramento and San Francisco and even Novato, it's been a phenomenal 10 months.
Go into it, man. I want to hear about it, because I think more people need to take that opportunity to meet up. I mean, I'm looking forward to trying to do my best to try to get to North Carolina for that international conference. And hopefully, you know, if that's a possibility that I'm able to do it, I'm hoping you go there, man. Like, hey, share a bunk, whatever, man. Let's, like, you know what I mean? Let's split the cost. Let's do all that. I want to be around, like,
I'm open
people,
to that.
You know what I mean? So that's something we could talk later on off air. But
absolutely.
Yeah, let me know. I want to know, like, you know, how you get this organization and just getting people together.
It happened. I'll give you like a 5-minute rundown of what this journey has been for me. I had a astronaut come to work and give a presentation. It was Mae Jameson. And she gave her presentation about women who are empowered and, you know, becoming an astronaut and whatnot. And I thought to myself, this is like in my face. This is where it became a thing where, I was researching Flutter. The deception was in my face. I said, I've had enough of this. I'm going to start creating content. So after that presentation from her, I went off and did my first little vlog. And then I got approached by a Sacramento Flat Earther and in my comment section. And I was elated. I was like, Sacramento, where are you, man? And so I got to meet you. And not to be too creepy, but it's like, you know, that's too much. And so that's what it was. Much. And from there, this guy, Tom's had the skinny, the whereabouts on Matt Powerland, and Matt was in my city. And I said, okay, Matt is in the city of Sacramento. What am I supposed to do? So I went and was shown where he was at, and I knocked on his door, you know, nervous, of course, because I'm just like anybody else. I was watching videos of Matt Powerland, right? So here I am knocking on my door. What's going to happen? And it turned out to be an amazing experience. I had lunch with him. I saw firsthand that this guy is a straight up workhorse for the flat earth. He's passionate about flat earth. I was totally re-inspired to find my own purpose and direction in this by being around somebody who has been doing it for a while. And that's kind of what I encourage anyone who is a flat earther in any shape, way, shape, or form, if you're whatever point that you are on the path, find somebody who can assist you with something that you're passionate about. So there's that. I come back from that meetup and I say to myself, I'm going to create the Sacramento Flat Earth Meetup for Sacramento. I'm going to put my own money into it. I put $60 into it for 6 months. And from there, I started going, posting, and I created the meetup on the webpage and was having meetups at Rayleigh's at the coffee, the Pete's Coffee. And people showed up. It was small at first, but I had two local friends show up. Then there was an outsider named Dean, and Dean is amazing. Dean found the Flat Earth Meetup by chance. He happened to research Flat Earth on his own. He's not in social networking or any of that. And he thought to himself the week prior, he goes, I wonder if there's a Sacramento Flat Earth Meetup. I'm sorry, a week later after I started. And sure enough, he joined. He goes, yeah, man, I'm just coming in off the cuff. And I was just like, this is amazing. I'm meeting people that I had never thought I'd be meeting. We're talking about Flat Earth. I mean, the buzz, imagine the buzz in early 2016. It was super good. So we were just together on this. And I continued to do commenting and social networking. And there was a post that just wanted to find out who's all from where. And I just was liking all the California people, you know. And one of the guys, Esteban, he's in San Francisco. He says, hey, I got a cool group. And can I add you to a secret group? And I was like, yeah, let's do that. And I says, hi, everybody there. And then I'm like, well, when are we going to meet? And we met in November. And I'm telling you, it has just been one of the most phenomenal experiences getting to know these friends. These friends of mine now. The conversations you'll have with, see, here's the thing about creating about flat earthers in my experience, right? Really cool. We know it's flat. So what are we going to hold back on? Nothing. We won't hold back on anything. And I'm not saying we're giving our personal emotional dumps all away, but we're able to talk openly and freely with amongst each other about the topics, the science, the emotional stuff, family, the friends, dude, all night. And so there would be meetups there. And then I would check in with Matt. And Matt didn't have anyone at the time. It was his birthday. I took him out to sushi, you know. And we're having, you know, we're eating sushi and having a good time. And, you know, I got an arm around him. He's a friend, you know. I'm at the point, I'm 34. And so, like, I'm at an age where I'm green, you know. My heart's open. And I'm forgiving it. If this guy's got whatever's attached to him is no concern of mine. He's building something with me as friends in Sacramento. He's in my city, and I'm a steward to my city. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So there was Matt. He came over here, and then after that week, I made dinner for him and his wife, Katie. And then Katie and I like Katie a lot. They're funny. He's funny. And then there's Mark Queen. So we go back to Novato. This is recently. We had another large flat earth meetup in Novato at Mark Queen's house. Another big content creator for flat earth and geopolitical awareness and holistic awareness type of things. And she was the beautiful, just accommodating host about my friend, about my family, about my sons and my wife. You know, because I we're all involved in this now, right? So. They were a shining example for my friends, for my boys and my wife. They didn't know what to expect. You know, my kids ain't around that, and they got other fathers that have come by, but nothing to this caliber. This is a full house, conversations going on, kids are playing, you know, they had a good time. But it was just it just goes to show that we are exceptional people. Flat earthers are exceptional, open-hearted people. In spite of the wailing and gnashing of teeth and things that could happen elsewhere, I'm telling you, make it real for yourself if you can. So try to get a meetup started. That would be good. And I think I know a guy in, you're in Orlando, I believe, right? So
no, sorry.
Oh, that's right. Well, anyway, I would encourage you to try to reach out and get a flat earth meetup started, just for 6 months. You know?
Yeah. I probably should do that. Like I said, I'm a shy person. To a degree.
Are you?
I'm learning how to get out of my comfort zone and, like, you know, even doing like interviews like this, like I told you last night, for most people, I don't hide. That's why I do blog style videos. That's why I show my face in my videos. That's why I do those kind of things, because I want people to know who I am. Like, I don't want to hide behind a microphone. I want people to know who I am. So I try to be kind of an open book, like,
clean cut vibe. I see for you, man. It's like you want people to see, but you're still, I get it. Go ahead.
Yeah. So
you shine though. Shine.
So like I tell people, I'm a barber. That's my trade. Right. That's what I do as a job. So I talk about flat earth almost 80% of the day. I'm telling my clients, I'm telling people who walk in, people overhear my conversation. I'm not shy about it. I talk about it. I defend it. People come back to me. It's funny to see the faces that I have a small debate with someone who's sitting in my chair. Guess what? They're literally in my chair for either 10 to 20 minutes. And in that 10 to 20 minutes, you're going to hear a lot of stuff and you can't get away from it because you have to sit in my chair. The other day, I had this old man. He had to be in his mid-60s, maybe 70. And I kept trying to, you know, I try to read my audience. I try to read who's in my chair. Well, it happens to be one of the guys next to me was asking me questions about pretty much flat earth. We weren't saying it flat earth, but he was getting to the point where the client all of a sudden turned around. This is the first time I ever cut this guy. And he's looking at me saying, what are you guys talking about? And I'm like, I have a YouTube channel where I talk about, you know, truther subjects. And again, I'm cutting his hair. The guy's having a conversation with me and he keeps turning around. After like the fourth time, I said, honestly, man, I make videos about the earth. Like, right away, it's funny how we're programmed. Right away, he says, I hope you're not one of those flat earthers. I said, well, I happen to be a flat earther, sir. And he's like, oh my God, how dumb can you? I said, before you say dumb, you should actually hear certain things. He said, well, let me know. So I started spitting stuff out. He came back at me with the same comment. Oh, boats go over the curve. You could see it from a plane. And I'm like, nope, you can't see it. Here's proof. Literally, I have iPads. I have all this in my station. So you want to say something? I'm going to show you proof. Show him all the proof. By the end of the conversation, end of the haircut, he goes, give me the name of your YouTube channel. I'm going to check it out. A month goes by. Next thing you know, he walks in. He's sitting down in somebody else's chair. He says, hey, by the way, I checked out your channel. This is a guy who's very standoffish. He goes, very interesting stuff. And I was like, really? He's like, yeah. And right there, I knew I hooked him because he didn't want to say, oh my God, I can't believe I'm about to believe this stuff, because he's an older gentleman. But when you start looking at the evidence, you can't deny it. Your only defense really is not looking at it. That's really what it is. It's not looking at it. So I get stuff like that happening. And that, to me, like, I bring it back to the whole biblical aspect. That's my pulpit. That's where God put me. That's my landmine. That's my field where I go out and I talk about this stuff. I try to bring more awareness to it. It took a while, you know, but I learned to hone my skills in that environment. And if anyone knows about barbershops, that's where you get a lot of conversations. People are willing to talk, and it's easier to talk in person with somebody than it is to have the, you know, keyboard champions that love to just hit and run. We get a comment, the earth is tits up. Like, that's easy to do, guys. You can just make stupid comments like that. Why don't you ask a real question? Why don't you look into the subject instead of just being ignorant about it? I don't know.
Well, that's because I feel psychologically that they are fully aware. The innate knowledge is there. And what happens is like this older gentleman, you reach a precipice where it's like, okay, if I keep asking the correct questions, I will probably flatten. And so I in my opinion, in my experience, I wanted to ask silly questions because if I knew if I would ask the right ones, then you start leading yourself down that road to truth. So if anyone's watching and they're doubting this experience, I'm just letting you know, you need to know yourself well enough to know what questions to ask yourself in regards to this material. And that's how that's how it goes. So, yeah. And do you have me ask you a question? Do you do haircuts for younger adults or kids or teenagers?
Yeah, everything, ages, man. Yeah, babies, okay. Old people, shaves. I've been doing this since I was 11 years old. I was cutting hair at 11 years old. So
wow, I was cooking at like some ages like that too. I like to cook.
It's just it's definitely, again, it's to me, it's a God given gift. And if you would have told me this is what I was going to be doing, I would have said possibly. I mean, at 11 years old, I was literally, it took me a week and a half to learn how to cut hair.
Oh.
It's weird. It just came natural. So I've been doing this for a long time. But it's just, you know, it is what it is. This is what I do. It's not who I am.
And I try it's to just tell your people craft.
I, yeah, it's just my
craft. Yeah, my craft.
But in the same aspect, I have days where I really enjoy it. And then there's days where it's just like,
man,
you can feel the energy of people and you can feel the weight that a lot of people hold. And that you take some of that stuff home with you. Like I could imagine a nurse, a doctor, anyone who's around people and you're physically touching them, you can start getting, and I'm not new age. That's not my thing. But you can have those feelings where you can feel the negativity of someone. And we all know this. I mean, you can read people. If you could read someone by just looking in their eyes, you know what's most likely they're thinking, they're going to be aggressive towards you or not. Everybody has this. So it's just one of those things that, yeah, I try to do my best to stay in my little bubble, but hey, people know where I stand.
Okay. I hear you. Well, not to get too off topic, but I mentioned personality types. I'm interested in Myers-Briggs personality types, the 16 different personality types. And so I've categorized myself and done the test over the years, over the last 9 years, and I test INFJ. And so we are a very rare type of psyche, and the males make up less than 0.5% of the population. And we're like the inside out human, where our psyche is, I operate from a place of 99% subconscious. My subconscious, what would be considered subconscious to you, is my conscious reality. Where, like, as some other normal people or regular people, I'll say, they'll have these aha moments where they have intuition strike them. I operate from intuition at all times. And so I've been researching the INFJ personality type a lot, because we do literally take the energy from someone if they walk into a room and they have certain situation going on, like personal issues. I'll know it. And then not only will I just know that that's happening to them, I become it with them. So I have to be careful about really who I take in as well. Hasn't stopped me from meeting other flat earthers, but it's been emotional for me, because some of the times I leave there, some of the meetups, and I'm charged up because I can feel these people. So don't worry, it's not new agey either. It's just, it's human being, it's human nature.
Yeah.
So, and it's what it's probably doing is helping you with your emotional intelligence, and that's going to just streamline your communication with other people down the road. Like I mentioned, like, not everybody needs to be flattened at all times. When I'm waiting for food in the lobby, waiting for my whatever it is, the person next to me, it's 5:45 p.m. We both probably just commuted and are hungry, and whatever the case may be, I'm not going to donk them over the head with flat earth right now. So I'll pass it up, you know, because I'm trying to feel who's open and who's not, or who wants what. So no worries.
No, I mean, I we're on the same page, man. Mm-hmm. Hold on. Mm-hmm. I have a message from Brent. He says, why does he sound robotic? If he sounds robotic, guys, that sucks. It's one of those things, but it could be just Skype messing up. I've heard rumors that Skype, after maybe you know, 20, 30 minutes, it starts getting a little bit wonky. So hopefully it fixes itself. Thank you, Brent, for letting me know that in the comments.
Thanks, man.
Yeah.
Sorry about that.
I can't believe we literally have 10 people watching and it's 1 o'clock my time. Like,
wow.
That's crazy. You know what I mean? So I appreciate everybody who's watching you.
Right on.
Commenting.
Thanks for being with us, guys.
Yeah, this is really cool. Again, I want to do more of this stuff. Hopefully I can find more time to do it.
Okay.
It's just, you know, it's, I want to expand my channel. I don't want to put it in a box. I want to make sure that, I can reach as many people, because there might be people who like live stream. There might be people who like documentaries. There might be people who like vlogs. And like we were talking yesterday, you know, I don't want to limit myself. I want to make sure that enough people feel, hey, we can, I like this dude, you know, I can relate to him in some way. So I appreciate that. Babylon Watch. Okay, I appreciate that. Thank you, Babylon, for saying that. Thank you, Brent, for joining the chat as well. Yeah, man. I miss being on some of those live streams too, man. But, you know, everybody, we start doing our own thing, and it's cool. It's cool. If you guys
it'll have come any, full circle.
Yeah, if you guys have any questions for him, for NorCal, please feel free to ask in the comments. Yeah, definitely. Feel free to come and just ask a question. Again, his links are down below. Let me ask you, do you have like goals for your channel? Like, will you see it in another year, potentially? Like, what do you think you might be doing?
My channel, the way I envision my channel is like this. A lot of channels are already doing the academia, the science, the high production quality. Who's giving themselves up to the journey of just being a candid, normal vlogging type of thing? And maybe it's out there and I'm not aware of it. But I am in a position to where I meet flat earthers. I may not document it well enough, but I'm constantly just sharing my state of being regarding this, as I'm saturated by a whole entire network of flat earthers that are around me. So who knows what it'll be. I plan on doing artwork. I'm going to do a mural in Sacramento. So I'm going to try to do a moon experiment and do some artwork, and kind of, that'll get reached 30,000 people. I know that Neil deGrasse Tyson's coming to Sacramento in May. I'm not sure how I want to play that, but I kind of want to throw a cog in the gear while he's in town. So I won't do something crazy, but I'm going to try to make something happen for my video or my content for that. But who knows? I mean, all I'm going to do is just keep my nose in flat earth, and whatever happens, happens. So
that's crazy.
Yeah.
So we have a question in the chat.
Yeah.
And again, I'll be honest. I'll tell you when I can answer a question and when I can't. You know, I'm not going to sit here and pretend to know everything. I could probably answer this at the same time. So hopefully you can both tackle it and help this person out. But they want to know, like, how do you explain tides?
The tides?
Yeah.
The way I look at tides is, well, you can approach it from, I think, the saltwater aspect of it, and the anode and the cathode, the sun and the moon, and barometric pressure. Barometric pressure, atmospherics, and pressure within, if you're even considering a dome model, you have barometric pressures, and these the sun and the moon could be in a sine wave form, creating these pockets of pressure that move and undulate throughout the system as a circuit, and could be moving the water in such a way. I could be off. What do you have on that? I mean,
I definitely don't believe that the moon is causing tides.
Right. Not in the way they tell us.
Yeah.
No,
not
absolutely.
Exactly, because
it doesn't affect lakes and large bodies.
Exactly. And you have to understand that the lights in the sky. So we're going to talk moon and the sun. We don't know what they are. I can honestly say I am not a scientist to say this is what it is 100% proof. Those guys don't know, but they don't want to let you know that they don't know, so they come up with these theories. Honestly, no one knows what they are. You know, we know that the sun is not 93 million miles away. We know that the moon is not a reflector of the sun. I mean, there's been great experiments from a lot of flat earth researchers that prove that the sun, I mean, that the sun does not send light to the moon, which then absorbs it and then sends it back to us, because the moon is a colder light. It literally gives off cold light. There's plenty of videos out there for that. So just research that. As far as gravity, gravity is just a theory. There are certain things that it takes, like there's like these steps that you take as you become a flat earther. Like you're literally letting go of different things. First, it became gravity. You know, oh, well, if you're not spinning, what is gravity? Because the spin of the earth supposedly is what holds things down and what also causes gravity. You know, well, right. If you're motionless, what is gravity? It doesn't exist. It's not. And I don't say it doesn't exist because, you know, there the force that pulls things down is just density. That's all it is. It's not this magical thing that picks and chooses what it wants to hold down.
Right.
It's nonsense. Right. So hopefully that helps you out. Hopefully.
Was there a gravity question in there?
Yeah, they said they're kind of iffy about gravity. So I just wanted to throw that in there that you should be iffy about, because it's not true, you know.
And so I have this on deck right now for anybody who is still questioning certain things. Now I recommend this book. This is The Greatest Light on Earth: Proof That Our World Is Not a Moving Globe, by Edward Hendry. There is astounding information, and gravity gets destroyed in this book. Destroyed. The fact that with gravitational pull, the supposed speed of the Earth at 1,000 miles an hour, gravitation should be quote unquote normal at the equator. What happens though is you have a spinning ball on gravity. The higher you go up on the ball, the force of gravity gets stronger. By the time you're up near the hole, you're like four times the force of gravity up top. None of these sensations are felt or recorded as you move or travel. No one gets on a plane in Alaska, goes to Florida, and comes off of the plane throwing up and feeling super light. Because they're going from not only the forces of gravity, not only should the forces of gravity increase as you go up, decrease as you go back to the equator, but your speed should change. So up here it's like 0 miles an hour, but you know you're right here about 750, and then the equator about 1,000 miles an hour. So people aren't coming off the plane from Alaska to Florida and throwing up because they're suddenly spinning faster.
That's the stuff that people don't think about.
They don't. Yes, and this is part of the lie. The lie has cut your mind off from your body, so you no longer feel that your common senses are even invalid anymore. You don't think that what you're feeling in your physiology is actually pertinent to what's happening, meaning at rest. And the same thing I did when I was talking to my wife about it the other day. I said, babe, you're sitting on the couch, we're chilling, and we're talking. Do you feel like you're spinning right now? It's not a trick question, guys. And, you know. So I
give you one more. Mm-hmm. So I just came back from vacation with the family. And, you know, we talked, and my wife does not want to hear about this stuff. She's not ready, and I have to accept that. I still try to, you know, drop little nuggets here and there. And as we're driving, I wish I had, I can't believe I said that. I wish I had a globe so I can demonstrate. But where we were was Central Florida. So we're in the middle of Florida. I live in South Florida. Mm-hmm. So you're talking about 200-300 miles. Okay, difference. We're driving. Everything's flat, by the way. Florida is, I mean, unless you start getting up north, it's pretty flat from central down. It's pretty flat. As we're driving, I said, do you realize we're technically supposed to be driving downhill now? She looked at me like, what do you mean? I said, think about it. If we live on a ball, we're supposed to be driving down to South Florida where we live.
Right.
I said, do you feel like we're driving down? I said, no, we've been going straight the whole time. And don't tell me it's supposed to be this big, it's too big to notice. No, you would notice that. You would notice things like that. And those are the little things, that little nuggets that, yeah, exactly. So, and remember, where Florida is, it's close to the equator.
Mm-hmm.
All right. So you're going to feel, remember, when you're closer to the equator, it's there's a big hump to that, you know, supposedly. So you would definitely feel like you were traveling downwards.
Yeah.
It's not what happens. That
map I just showed you, held it up. That was a map that categorizes all the states by flatness, order of flatness, and Florida is number one.
Exactly. Literally, that's one of the things that when I started doing this kind of research, I'm like, oh my God, I live in South Florida. Like, this is flat. Like, I can see. I even listen, and this is something I'm bringing to my channel. I bought a drone. Okay, I bought a drone, and literally, I'm gonna be doing videos like this where I just take this straight up, okay, and you could see as the higher you get, the higher the horizon comes, it just climbs up with you. It doesn't dip away from you like it's supposed to. I mean, that whole aspect of people saying, you know, it's impossible. You've just been told this so much that you just expect to see something that's not there. And I've had, you know, conversations with my brother, and he tried to tell me, oh, there was times when he was flying on a plane and he had to go 7 miles up. So when he went 7 miles up, that's when he seen the curve. And I was like, well, how about this air balloon that went 10 miles up that didn't see no curvature? You know, like, you wanted to see a curve, so you're telling me you saw a curve. There's no curvature, man. Like, you know, these are the things that you deal with, because most people think that this is, I mean, you've been told so much that it has to be, it can't just all be flat. It has to be a curve somewhere. And you put it in your mind's eye. You think you're seeing something that's not there. You've just been told too many times. But it's little things like that that, I mean, the fact that I was driving, it came to me like, I should be driving down. Like, I should be going downhill. You know what I mean? And our horizon should be like way down there. It shouldn't be at my eye level now that I'm driving down. It's like those little details that most people miss. You have to understand. It's things like that should not be happening.
Just like they miss the detail of shooting stars shooting up. You know, every time you see a shooting star or a comet asteroid,
no matter where you are,
is coming down at a declination. Even if it looks super horizontal, like it's declining, okay? Heliocentric model should show you shooting stars any all which way. Never happens. And that's kind of like the opposite perspective. Like, if you're driving over, like you're saying, Florida, why wouldn't you see some shooting stars going up? You know what I mean? Like, it just, you know. So really what you need to be doing is rebuild. Go learn your heliocentric model the correct way that you think it is. Warm up in the wrong court. I'll tell you right now, just go do it, because you're going to need to know both models. That's why I call my playlist Teach the Controversy. It's a little more involved than that, but teach yourself this controversy. You need to reevaluate the heliocentric model, not the assumed one that you have coming into this. And well, Flat Earth Academia will force you to relearn your heliocentric model so that they can bust it wide open.
Really, that's one thing that, man, I didn't think I was going to understand or learn so much of this information, because you really have to learn what mainstream science is teaching, right? So it's like, you graduate of high school, you go to college, you forget all this stuff, mm-hmm. right? And then you start researching Flat Earth, and you have to learn the actual model. So then when you get into some sort of debate or just discussion with a globe head, they don't even know what they believe. That's the sad thing. So you're explaining their model while then trying to defend your model. And it's like, okay, you know what? Let me just break it down. Let's get back to the facts. That's the most important thing. And that's what I've learned. Because it was like I was spending too much time trying to, no, that's not what it is. You're spinning at these crazy, and they don't even think that, you know, because Hollywood doesn't show that. Hollywood shows these movies where they're flying in space and just everything looks still. So it looks still. That's how it must be. First of all, you know, that's a production, and it'll become almost impossible for them to, you know, show you what the real model that they portray to be as truth. It's just so dumb and so ridiculous that they can't even do that, you know. And this is with millions of dollars in a budget. They can't reproduce what they actually believe.
In the name of science, of all things, in the name of science, they won't show you the fourth wall. They'll never pan 360 degrees to show you. They'll never use another satellite that's out there to take a shot of another satellite. They'll never put a camera on the moon to film the Earth. What else won't they do? JPL hosted a press conference when the Juno mission was finally really getting some good data. And somebody asked him a question, what's your favorite instrument on the Juno satellite? And the new guy is answering, he's like, well, you know, I kind of think of them like my kids, and they're all kind of the same here. That's just finagling, pathetic conversation, not in the name of science. And really, I'm not even super duper scientific prior, but the amount of money that they're putting into this should tell you that you should get some good solid answers. And it's just a farcical thing, as we see with the ISS. They're getting in monkey costumes and playing guitars and putting on jerseys and doing flips. So it's all totally suspect. And not only that, the people who are still researching or in the early phases of the debate, you can tell that they don't take pride in their model. They don't feel they're very angry and ugly about certain things, but they don't speak about it beautifully, eloquently, or confidently. It's always this hard. You could tell by the way they had to learn it, that the way they regurgitate it out is like garbage in, garbage out. There's no pride. They take no pride. Whereas flat earthers are waking up thankful to being on the beautiful flat earth. We're embracing the basics like perspective and vanishing point. We're talking about water being level. I mean, water has takes on its whole new personality. It has a new character. It's a new character element now. The water that I knew prior to flat earth is not the same water that I consider now. Okay. It's not going to conform to the exterior of a shape, period.
I'm glad we get into this, because this is really, you know, part of hopefully any newcomer, anyone who's just looking into this, diving in for the first time. One of the reasons why I wanted not just to do an interview with you, but others in the future is, there are a lot of disinformation. You know, I said this in a video, maybe one of my last vlogs, is that even though that there was less material a year and a half ago, 2 years ago, there weren't these channels devoted to misleading you. So once you did get into Flat Earth, the information was more reliable. Yeah. Where even though there's, I guess, maybe millions of videos now, right, about this subject, there's a lot of channels dedicated to providing misinformation. So in part, I kind of feel for the newer generation flat earthers that are coming into this at this point, because, yeah, you're going to find a lot of great information, but you're going to find just as much shill kind of information is just meant to Eric Dubé, gatekeep you from really understanding the full truth of the flat earth. And one of the biggest things for my channel, and one of the things that I've started to hear myself on a regular basis is learning the model, at least learning the basic model of what the flat earth is, because most people do not understand it. And that's where most of the arguments come from, not understanding what the model, the basic model is supposed to be, knowing that Antarctica is an ice wall. You know, that's really almost like the key, because you get the stupid comments that you're going to fall off an edge. No, you're being held in by this great barrier.
If there was this edge, this would be called edge earth theory.
That's
not edge earth theory.
And that was part of the indoctrination that we all got as kids, and why it gets so many people so mad is the first thing they're going to say is, well, where's the edge? Are you going to fall off of it? We all seen the pictures where it looks like this boat is going to go off this cliff. They done that on purpose. So that you start off with the premise of flat earth as thinking it can't be, because you're going to fall off some sort of magical edge. Like, yeah, you're not going to fall off a spinning ball. Come on, man. Think. Please think. Use your own mind. God gave you a beautiful mind. You can use it to think for yourself. You know, don't listen to me. Please don't listen to me. I'm just another person. I'm just another human. NorCal is the same. He's just trying to learn and teach. But don't take our word for it. Do the research yourself. That's the most important thing. Because if we can convince you the earth is flat, someone can convince you it's not. And that's not what we want. We want you to convince yourself. Because if you can convince yourself with the research you've done for yourself, then nobody can take that away from you.
Yeah. Don't rush the process. Don't think about, okay, well, why would they lie right away? Trust me, I had nights where I was almost bent over the toilet about to throw up going through the NASA deception edgy like portion of this awakening. You'll have your moments where you turn your eye towards NASA or any other space agency. I call them the establishment of curvature at this point. But going back to the edge topic, for those who need talking points or want to gather something, you could, of course, say, well, where's the edge of space? But that's more of you're not really – that will work for some people, and that's, I understand that. But what I just mentioned previously was, why don't we see any shooting stars going up? Mm-hmm. So if you're talking about edge Earth, you know, the edge, well, then you could tell them, well, if there's an edge out there and I'm a flat earther, why don't I see, you know, anything coming up? And that would infer that there is no space beneath. It's not a pizza pie. You know, if there were a pizza pie in space, then you would see, you know, asteroids or stars going, or shooting stars traveling straight up. So there's a logical way to approach that retort, and there's a philosophical or whatever. So pick your direction. But
yep. And that's true. And in the chat, they're talking about asteroids too. And that's another thing. We don't know what those things are. Okay. We've been told there's some sort of rock. We don't know what those are. Have NASA ever grabbed a satellite and just tracked it all the way into orbit and, you know, seen it? Like, have we had it? Like, if you're driving by a car and you see another car, you know that car is going a certain speed, right? You've never seen a video showing an asteroid coming into it. We've seen it with our eyes, but we don't know what those things are, right? We don't know. They're definitely not satellites. That's a video that I have coming up talking about satellites and stuff like that. Because there are satellites, just not what you've been told. I believe that there are satellites just in, you know, kind of like in high altitude balloons, which is
the Raccoon projects.
Yeah,
absolutely.
Look into that, you'll know that is what a satellite is. You know, not this thing that that's flying through space. Which, again, here's another clue for people. How come in any of the Earth pictures you don't see a single satellite? You don't see a single star. You don't see a single satellite. You don't see – these are little things that, like, once you start waking up to this, you're like, wait a second. These things are missing. So it's not necessarily what's supposed to be there. It's what's not there that starts waking you up to it too.
Just in case there's somebody who has my similar background coming from the ufology aspect and you're researching a lot of cases – the Black Knight satellite is a mysterious object that has been talked about, right, in ufology. In my opinion, after reviewing the other videos on the Raccoon projects, this is Raccoon, meaning that you have super filled helium balloons that are in the upper atmosphere. Now, I suspect that the Black Knight satellite is a partially deflated helium canopy that's just aloof out there in some way, shape, or form. I'm just throwing that out there. But definitely look into the Raccoon projects, stuff that the Army was involved in the 50s and 60s and 70s. Flat Earth is going to take you into into the past a little bit, and that's good. That's part of the academia. The academia, of course, talks about the measurement, flat measurements of the topographical locations on Earth. You're going to have to look at all the different square mile examples of perfectly flat terrain. You're going to want to look at the sun and the moon being closer, of course. The sun and the moon, they're advanced topics, but you just have to play with the material there. You're going to want to look at the stars. You're going to want to look at the seasons. You're going to want to maybe research electromagnetism, mm-hmm. magnetism, density, mass and acceleration, just whatever it is. It's endless research and inquiry. And which is why I've already told myself I'm going to be on this path probably, till the day I die, truly, because this is where I'm finding purpose, is to just know. And it's like the science of the ages. All of our ancestors have been constantly looking at the stars, the same stars, mind you, the same ones. We have been trying to figure this out for the longest time. And so it's a commendable life pursuit, whether you're known for anything or not. And this is, I wanted to mention this as well. Whether you're meeting a notorious or popular flat earther, there is just as much magic or significance when you find another regular old Joe flat earther. In my opinion, it has been, they're both equally phenomenal. So take pride in the fact that you may be researching it, in the closet for right now. There's nothing wrong with that.
It's not. And there definitely is a lot of closet flat earthers that are.
Yeah.
And I say, I understand. I can understand where you're coming from. First time I try to present this to somebody, it's like knowing a language but not knowing how to speak the language. You can understand it, but you can't speak it. And that's what happened with me. I understood once I learned that, wow, we live on a flat, possibly enclosed, Earth. I learned that and I could say that out loud to myself, I wanted to share it. But I realized most of what I was saying to them was like, you got to watch this 2-hour video. No, nobody want to sit there for 2 hours. Like, they're not going to be like me, who couldn't sit through a 2-hour video. You know what I mean? They're going to be like, no. And then I started learning, well, if they're not going to watch a 2-hour video, what can I learn, to help them understand? Just a few points. Again, being a barber, I started honing my skills. I started understanding how to not just approach them with this information, but then how to back up the information.
Yes, having a total natural, relatable conversation like two people could.
And it took time. That's the biggest thing. It took time. It wasn't overnight with me. It took me 6 to 7 months before I could admit it. And then once I got past that point to actually have a conversation with somebody, when I wasn't telling them, hey, watch this 3-hour video, like I had to learn. It was like, you live and learn. Like when I approached my wife, I gave her too much. I asked too much of her, and it might have burned her out really quickly. That's why she might be turned off for this right now.
Yeah.
But I learned that, now I can not make that mistake with someone else.
So if we're going to go there, then I'll reveal a little bit about my interactions with my wife, because I made a video on February, because in February, I noticed that flat earthers were either falling out of their relationships or marriages were under stress because of this topic. And we don't talk about the love angle enough in flat earth, right? Someone's got to talk about it. So I took a walk and I talked about what my true path and being married and together with my wife, been with her for like 11 years now. And the thing of it is, it's great to have open-minded discussion. It's great for you to do your research, but I realize you kind of have to lean in a little bit, let them know where you're at, have them come back a little bit, and then maybe later come back with where you're at later. So I had to talk to my wife in segments about clutter. I wasn't quiet for a long, long time, and then hit her with everything I had in store. I'm not saying that you did either. I'm just saying.
Oh, did you?
Oh man.
I think the earth's like, she's like, what? What are you talking about? I was like, I went too much on her, but sorry to interrupt.
No, it's all good. It's all good. Man. So you hit her hard. So like, that's like with the night that the Japan quake happened in 2011. I went into my wife in the bedroom, and I get on the bed, and I'm like shaking. I'm like, there's a big earthquake happening in Japan. And she was livid. But sometimes you know, it's fun. It's because my nose is always in it. And sometimes I don't want to include her because look, book.
That's awesome.
Book. You know what I mean? And I write graffiti, flat earth graffiti. And so there's times where I don't want to be bothered for weeks on end. But like, I'm just trying to say, just sometimes I lean in and let her know where I'm at. And like one night I was doing unloading the dishwasher, because I'm a regular dude, right? I'm unloading the dishwasher, and I'm like, babe, am I going crazy? No, you're fine. All right, cool. And coincidentally, I get back on, this is like 2015. This wasn't like a super easy thing to get into with emotional support, right? So I get back into the chat the next day, and some other dude was like, man, I thought I was losing my mind last night, and I had to get reassured by my significant other that I'm cool still and whatnot. And I was like, me too, you know? Like, it happens. You're gonna have a psychological slip. I talked about this. I woke up one morning and I instantly wrote my ideas down because this is like at the really turn of the point where, like you said, after 7 months, you knew, right? I reached a point where I wanted to talk about how the flattening process affected my psychological cognitive stack. So the first thing is
No, keep going. But we did. It kind of like paused.
Gotcha. So part,
but yeah.
So we're back. There's three phases to flattening, in my opinion. The first one, you're just like, no way, this is true. This can't be a deception. But if you acknowledge the deception, that's part one. Step two is you're on the fence. You don't know whether it's a ball or if it's flat. You're too shy to say anything. You're not even imagining yourself saying it. Just feels like blasphemy. So you have this psychological free-floating feeling where you just truly don't know where you are. And that is where the liberation starts to kick on. You're just totally liberated in that moment. And then you come down, feet rest on the ground, phase three. You accept the fact that the earth is flat and stationary, and you close a chapter in your life that you're basically never going to go back to, because once you see this, you won't unsee it. You know, anytime you see a ball, you're like...
Yeah, here's another globe. I actually want to buy a globe just so I can be like, see, this is why this is wrong. This is why this is wrong. This is why, you know, before I used to walk in, it was like a cat. I didn't want to see one of those. But as you mature in this whole process, you start realizing, you know, let's use their weapons against them, you know. So I'm not as like, here's a perfect example. As soon as I got out of work, again, my wife's out of town. I usually work, come home, hang out, do some editing or something like that. Very homebody. I'm not one to go out or do nothing like that. My vice is usually going to a movie. Tonight I watched that movie Life. The first like 5 minutes of it, I was like, but then I was like, okay, I understand that literally I'm probably the only one in this that realizes, besides this just being a movie, that there is no space and these people have no clue, right? So I was like, calm down, bring me back to being flat, right? Okay. The whole movie is just about the ISS, and to me, it's just showing them, like, this has to be real, right? But if you have eyes to see and ears to hear, you know what you picked up on that movie? What I've picked up? They do everything that the real ISS does not do, like close hatches and have all these precautions everywhere.
Right.
The whole movie literally destroys what reality is when you look at real ISS footage that's supposed to be real. It literally makes it. I mean, if you have woken up to this and you see this movie, you're going to be like, wow, like this. It's sad for people who believe that the ISS is real, because if you just look at it and you see that they're closing and opening hatches every time they leave a certain section of, because they're scared that if anything happens, there's a breach. Like, just the common sense stuff that they do not do. They do not care. It's just after seeing the movie, I was just like, all right, I calmed down. I understand what they're feeding these people, why they're doing it, why lately. It seems within the last 2-3 years, they're pushing even more and more space movies. This whole, we're not going to make another Star Wars. And all of a sudden, they're starting to ramp up Star Wars movies left and right. It's unheard of, because they're trying to do damage control. And as long as they can keep making people believe that this could be a possibility, this might be reality, a lot of people are going to stay asleep.
Let me add to that, because you're touching on something that I also feel that is a interesting portion to the deception. And this is an original newspaper article, Man on the Moon, Sacramento Bee. I have a copy. This is evidence of a crime, by the way, so I'm going to take this to court when it's time. But what I'm trying to remind people here is that the moon landings or anything related to space exploration is tied to American exceptionalism. It's almost patriotic to be concerned for the safety of these men. Oh, somebody died on the way to the moon. And, all the things that we know are lies. But nevertheless, the point I'm trying to make here is that in your gut, you feel this emotional attachment, and this is where they hide behind it. They try to hide the deception. So they're making movies where, they're doing a spacewalk probably in that movie where it's risky, or something got blown off and he's trying to hold on for dear life. They try to exude these heroic things that are concerned with, space. And just like you mentioned, in the real footage, what do you see? You got bubbles of water going boop, boop. And, you can laugh at it all day, truly, but what is it? Propaganda. I mean, it's just, that's what it is. For those who are late in line, part of the last waivers, then you're just sucking down that propaganda, man.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Supporting the cabal.
Yeah, watching CNN and Fox News for your truth, and you're not going to get nowhere with that. And the funny thing is, before I even became a flat earther and was into any kind of conspiracy, I mean, it doesn't take much to realize people are pushing something down, like the education system, everything is like, I always seen that, right? I've always noticed that there is always some sort of agenda behind what we've been taught, how we've been taught, especially as you become I became a father and doing homework with my son, it was like, wait a second, this is nothing like what we were being taught. Like, they're dumbing you down. Like, they're giving you homework that makes no sense for a kid your age. Like, what do they expect? It's just ridiculous, the education system that we've been presented. So I was telling a customer today, because he was talking about how he might move and he's looking for a good school system that has better, grades for the school. And I'm like, dude, you already know where I stand. You're there on board with me. An A school is still teaching the same thing as a D school or an F school. They're all teaching you the wrong crap. Like, so what is the difference? Like, the only difference is the building might be better. It might be in a better neighborhood. But they're all teaching you exactly the same phony nonsense agenda. Keep you dumbed down. Here's some more fluoride in your water. It's just, I was like, remember that. So don't stress out too much. Move wherever you are.
That's it. Don't stress out, because we're not, even as fathers, knowing what we know, we're actually at an advantage to where our children, I'm not going to I'm not going to really judge or hang it over my kids' heads. If, as long as they have fun learning, even if it's the wrong information, you know, you could corner me for saying that, but I'm just saying the process of retaining the information, it needs to be at least fun for them. If there's no fun being had, then I'm not going to trip if they get a bad grade because they're just miserable. So I have a lot of leeway for them personally because of that.
That's cool right there. I'm different. I'm like, you know, you remember what I told you, boy. Don't listen.
No, Ab, don't get me wrong. But in knowing that the way that system is almost militarized I'm not going to stress too hard on my kids because I don't want to instill in them the anxieties of rushing. We're just rushing to get out the door to get to our slave masters. So why am I going to add more pressure when we come back home on the other end, coming full circle? Mm-hmm. It's just miserable for them, you know, in some ways. Yeah. You got to look out for our little ones, man. Well, there's that one dude in an older video. It's the KGB guy talking, saying you could change the whole generation, the whole mindset in 3 generations. Have you seen that old school clip?
Yep.
Anyway, and what I'm trying to say here is that they could MK us all day if they try, but what they can't do is get our hearts, right? So if there's going to be an MK situation that my kids may be going to during the day, I get to do the heart work. And they can't override the heart. And that's where I'm trying to get my kids to understand. And you could probably change. You don't have to change the consensus of the populace in 3 generations with working at the mind manipulation. You could change things real quick with the heart. And that's my goal. And so my kids are fully exposed to Flat Earth Talk. I can't hide it. You know, Matt's been over here for crying out loud. So of course they're hearing Flat Earth Talk, you know.
And that's and that's how it should be. I mean, as
absolutely
as parents, as you know, aunts and uncles, whatever, you know, you let them know, give them the option at least to know the difference between the two. And again, I'll go back to the Bible. If you teach them right, they might depart for a little while, but they'll come back. And you have to just trust it. That you've done enough work that they will come back and God will, you know, bring them back to reality.
The best way to train yourself to have a dialogue with anyone is to talk Flat Earth with children, because you don't need to shove a model down their throat. That's not how I work with my kids on this. What I do is talk about the basics. So I don't even mention the shape of the Earth at all. We talk about fluid dynamics, water resting. We talk about thermodynamics. I just talked a bit to my oldest about that, heat dissipation and things like that. And I just told him about 3 weeks ago about parallax. I said the word parallax. He's trying to understand, trying to talk to him about the angle of perception and how things move as you cover ground. You know, the angles of perception should change. It's called parallax. And he goes, oh, because I was saying, you know, there's no parallax in the stars and things like that. So you don't need to, even if I were to never mention the topic to my children, if I always remind them about perspective, the laws of perspective, if they understand these things, I don't even need to tell them about it. Of course I will, but they'll have the tools, is what I'm saying. I'm not robbing my children of the fact that they have the senses to get this regardless. So that's it. Fluid dynamics, perspective. Keeping, you know, my kids in mind with certain topics like that as a parent, that's the dialogue I have with my children. I don't talk about who's lying to who and ISIS or ISS being fake and all that. That's,
And that's it. You show them the actual evidence of what reality is. And I try to do the same thing. I want to touch on one last thing before we go.
Okay.
We've been going for a little over an hour and a half. It's flown by for me. And like I said, I got to work tomorrow. So I'm like, but it's all good. I can do this for this kind of conversation because it's edifying and it just, you know, fellowship is something that all people need.
Yes.
So there was a comment that wanted us to touch base on, what we think of these athletes or celebrities coming out lately. And I know we talked a little bit about this, so I'll give you the floor and you know, go with it.
Well, we're going to see, no matter what, we're going to see celebrities talk about this. This is where it gets a little serious here, because we understand that there is a Breton circus, there is a cabal that can utilize the celebrities as a weaponized force against our perception and our dispositions. If you are aware of any of this, you know that basketball players, based on what they wear, what music, what headphones they're wearing when they go to the game, this all affects the way the culture is will shift. So don't hang on any of these guys' words. We just got done talking about how important it is to flatten yourself and to understand this for yourself. But it is interesting for me to see Kyrie. I think Kyrie is still an interesting aspect in this. Trying to gauge where he's coming from was interesting. Shaq threw us for a loop, but we see now that as a Mason, his role in this was probably to just come in as an overbearing, overshadowing, attention-sucking vortex to get off of Kyrie's genuine golden disposition. Because Kyrie's thing is much different from what Shaq just tried to pull. That's not even if it's an athlete, we've got AJ Styles. We've got the other basketball player, the bald dude, I don't know his name. Look at the way these people's mannerisms are, see? Most people are in it. All I'm trying to say is, follow their eyes, follow their demeanor. Try to and rewatch it again and see if it's in their loins. Like AJ Styles, he was cornered by his other wrestling buddy. He was like, AJ's a flat earther now. He's a flat earth theorist. And AJ was like, near the end, he forgot about the programming. He just said, you know what? You couldn't even handle this, dude. That's how he said it. Like, it was street talk. Like, dude, you couldn't even handle this information if you looked at it. And I'm like, shh, this dude, you know what I mean? He's on it. Like, you can tell when people are researching it and those who are maybe coming in as a mouthpiece and just whatever.
And, you know. And I could appreciate, like you said, how he put the guy back in his place. Never right. saying he was, but he
That's
was
right.
allowing people to understand that you should be able to question whatever they tell us. And that was key, you know. Yes. I felt that Kyrie definitely was being sincere. I'm glad I didn't do a video about Shaq. That's one of the things that I'm going to try to make sure that I do not rush into videos because of that. You know, we had a couple guys had to repost like, hey, this guy ended up backing out, you know. And not that there's something wrong with that. Because there's not. We're trying to get out information. But at the same time, I think we have a responsibility to make sure that the information we have, we complain about them fact-checking, we should be doing the same thing. We shouldn't be so right. Or at least, like in my video, I try to commentate on it. Hey, this guy just said this. I'm going to give you my 2 cents of why I think he might be for real. Or you can do the same thing and say, well, there's a chance that this guy might be talking crap, but I want at least people to know, you know. I think that's that should be more of the approach we take. I'm not trying to put a ruler across the whole thing, but I'm just saying, as researchers, just because someone says the word flat earth doesn't mean that we should necessarily jump on it. I think we should commentate on it, and there's a difference.
Look at where it's gotten the scientism sector. They have their celebrities in place. They've got their Bill Nye. They've got Brian Cox, Neil deGrasse Tyson. If flat earth is a truth that becomes exposed, they're going to do the same dang thing over there. And I'm telling you, as soon as that happens, you are going to miss the train on what this really is about. Because that sector, that cabal, that part of the matrix, that part of the machine does not care about you. It will steamroll right over your existence, and they will make profit off the flat earth, and they will most likely skew it in a way that they can probably use to some kind of nefarious advantage. I mean, the evidence of doing that kind of crap is all around us. So, and that's why if the groundswell of flat earth really begins to take off, which I feel that it is, I totally is, they're going to need to keep it. They're going to need to come down to here to talk about what we're talking about, which is why Shaq never talked about what proofs he had, who he got information from, or any of that. Because if you do that, you know exactly, you're coming right back into the grassroots movement of where this has been for the last 2-3 years, right? Yeah. I mean, straight up, there's no way around it. So it's all posturing, in my opinion.
And I think on that note, we're going to
open it up.
And this was great. This was awesome.
Nice.
Brother, give them your information. Let them know where you can reach. For the most part, if you guys just check the description, you'll see I have all the links in there. But, you know, let them know what you got coming up and, you know, just what's going on.
Yeah. If you're any way, shape, or form interested in another dude who is a flat earther, who's going around meeting people and sharing the journey, if that's what you want, is somebody who's just going to share their heart, then go ahead, by all means, find me on YouTube. I'm NorCal Waters on YouTube. I'm NorCal Waters on Facebook. I do have a family account, like my own personal account, but I don't really share Flat Earth there, so it's just me being me. But I wanted to separate the two because I like to, as you can see, I have the books. So I try to, the books that I'm reading, I try to put segments in my Flat Earth journey. The NorCal Waters on Facebook is like my academia side of sharing Flat Earth material. My YouTube channel is more just me being me, shaking hands and seeing Flat Earth in other people's faces. There you go.
And you definitely, you'll enjoy his content, especially if you like my little vlogs that I've done. He does very similar vlogs where he just takes you through the journey, and that's what it's really all about. It's just taking someone through the journey that you're awakening to, and just the excitement at times, the disappointment at others, the whole thing. You know, you get to experience that, and I think it's really powerful. It definitely closes, you know, this earth that we live on, it brings it a little bit closer, and it brings this family atmosphere into the whole aspect, and that's really important.
That's what you're doing. That's what I'm trying to do. Thank you for reaching out to me and building this connection with me, man. I really appreciate it because this is exactly what people need to see.
Yeah.
Relatableness.
And like I was trying to tell people, for those who will watch now or watch later, literally, this is our second time conversation. Okay.
Yeah.
It's just that, you know, it just, something clicked. Hey, we just became, you know, two buddies talking and just having a conversation. I'm glad. I'm really appreciative for everyone who stuck around. I mean,
me too.
This time at night, and you guys are hanging out with us. That's awesome, you know, especially for me who doesn't really do this live streaming stuff enough. I know people don't really think of my channel as that, but I do want to introduce this more and more. But again, I'm so thankful that you were, you know, you said yes.
Likewise.
I appreciate it. Guys, if you haven't, go subscribe to this channel. If you haven't subscribed to my channel, go subscribe. I appreciate it. We should have more conversations in the future. You know,
you're ready, baby. Yeah. You're ready. All day.
You guys let me know in the comments if there's someone you want me to talk to, by the way. I try to do that. I've been trying to reach out to individuals that I feel a kind of connection with where I don't want it to be awkward. You know, I'm not a professional interviewer, so it's very relaxed and stuff, and I want to make sure that...
I'm sorry to interrupt you, but you said you wanted to build a community on your channel. I'm going to commit to that, man. I'm going to try to... When you drop some material, I'm still learning. I'm going to have to ask questions to you, too. So I would like to definitely commit to being part of your community on your YouTube channel, bro. Absolutely.
I appreciate that. And I say that the same for everybody. This is how we get to know each other. I had a kid come in when I first started out. I was like, hey, we should do a hangout. And I was like very standoffish because, I'm honest. I'm not that kind of guy who can just jump on, like, you know. This guy, for you guys to know, I asked him to come on. We started talking, you know, offline, just, hey, you know, I asked him a couple questions. Do you have a microphone? Do you have a webcam? This guy went out and got all this stuff, okay? like within a few hours of me just asking him. Why? Because he realized, you know, this could be an opportunity that he can do more interviews with other people, and it's an investment in his channel. I didn't want him to spend money. I was just asking the question, and the guy took it upon. That's what I love about this man. Like he's down. He wants to help out. He knows that, like I've always stressed out, is people judge you, right? And if you got bad audio, bad quality, bad, that's why I try to, you know, fancy this up, because yeah. First impressions are a lot, right? And if I have the ability to do this stuff, I just learned this. You can tell you, I was trying to figure this out. That's why we were late. I was trying to figure some of this stuff out even now. So it is what it is. I'm having fun with it. I'm glad I met another brother doing this. This is really powerful stuff that I'm glad I'm able to be a part of. So with that, I'm gonna close off. I'm gonna say thank you. And thank you to you, brother, for coming and hanging out, and everybody. Thank you guys. Yes. And it's not gonna be the last time. We're definitely gonna get back on this. Just bear with me. I try to make time. As a family man, it's hard to find those gaps in the day. Thank you guys, and see you guys.
Take care, brother.